إن هذا القرآن يهدي للتي هي أقوم ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا كبيرا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الله يعلم ما تحمل كل أنثى وما تغيض الأرحام وما تزداد وكل شيء عنده بمقدار. عالم الغيب والشهادة الكبير المتعال. سواء منكم من أسر القول ومن جهر به ومن هو مستخف بالليل وسارب بالنهار. له معقبات من بين يديه ومن خلفه يحفظونه من أمر الله. إن الله لا يغير ما بقوم حتى يغيروا ما بأنفسهم. وإذا أراد الله بقوم سوءا فلا مرد له وما لهم من دونه من وال. هو الذي يريكم البرق خوفا وطمعا وينشئ السحاب الثقال. ويسبح الرعد بحمده والملائكة من خيفته ويرسل الصواعق فيصيب بها من يشاء وهم يجادلون في الله وهو شديد المحال. له دعوة الحق والذين يدعون من دونه لا يستجيبون لهم بشيء إلا كباسط كفيه إلى الماء ليبلغ فاه وما هو ببالغه وما دعاء الكافرين إلا في ضلال. ولله يسجد من في السماوات والأرض طوعا وكرها وظلالهم بالغدو والآصال. قل من رب السماوات والأرض قل الله. قل أفاتخذتم من دونه أولياء لا يملكون لأنفسهم نفعا ولا ضرا. قل هل يستوي الأعمى والبصير أم هل تستوي الظلمات والنور. أم جعلوا لله شركاء خلقوا كخلقه فتشابه الخلق عليهم. قل الله خالق كل شيء وهو الواحد القهار. أنزل من السماء ماء فسالت أودية بقدرها فاحتمل السيل زبدا رابيا. ومما يوقدون عليه في النار ابتغاء حلية أو متاع زبد مثله كذلك يضرب الله الحق والباطل فأما الزبد فيذهب جفاء وأما ما ينفع الناس فيمكث في الأرض كذلك يضرب الله الأمثال للذين استجابوا لربهم الحسنى والذين لم يستجيبوا له لو أن لهم ما في الأرض جميعا ومثله معه لافتدوا به أولئك لهم سوء الحساب ومأواه جهنم وبئس المهاد أفمن يعلم أنما أنزل إليك من ربك الحق كمن هو أعمى إنما يتذكر أولو الألباب الذين يوفون بعهد الله ولا ينقضون الميثاق والذين يصلون ما أمر الله به أن يوصل ويخشون ربهم ويخافون سوء الحساب والذين صبروا ابتغاء وجه ربهم وأقاموا الصلاة وأنفقوا مما رزقناهم سرا وعلانية ويدرؤون بالحسنة السيئة أولئك لهم عقبى الدار جنات عدن يدخلونها ومن صلح من آبائهم وأزواجهم وذرياتهم والملائكة يدخلون عليهم من كل باب سلام عليكم بما صبرتم فنعم عقبى الدار بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذ قال إبراهيم رب اجعل هذا البلد آمنا واجنبني وبني أن نعبد الأصنام رب إنهن أضللن كثيرا من الناس فمن تبعني فإنه مني ومن عصاني فإنك غفور رحيم ربنا إني أسكنت من ذريتي بواد غير ذي زرع عند بيتك المحرم ربنا ليقيموا الصلاة فاجعل أفئدة من الناس تهوي إليهم وارزقهم من الثمرات لعلهم يشكرون ربنا إنك تعلم ما نخفي وما نعلن وما يخفى على الله من شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء الحمد لله الذي وهب لي على الكبر إسماعيل وإسحاق إن ربي لسميع الدعاء رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل دعاء ربنا اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Exalted be the name of our Lord, the Most High, the Most Excellent. He it is who forgives sins and accepts the tawbah from those who repent. Through His remembrance and dhikr, the heart finds peace and its content. He do we turn to seek protection from His divine anger and eternal punishment. May peace and salutations be upon the final messenger whom He sent. Today, insha'Allah ta'ala, we will be doing two surahs, Surah Ar-Rad and Surah Ibrahim. And they are both Makki surahs. They're both relatively short. Each one's around 6 pages or so. And they're both in the middle of the Meccan phase, maybe even early to late middle. So maybe around 4th or 5th year of the preaching of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Hence, both of these surahs, they have that fiery eloquence that characterizes this era of revelation. And as I said, both of them, they're around a quarter juz. So we're actually going to be doing a shorter amount today, but there's two surahs. And because they're so beautiful and because they're so majestic, I thought we would spend some extra time on these two surahs. Surah Ar-Ra'd translates as the surah of lightning. The surah of lightning. Why? Because in verse 12, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that it is He who shows you the lightning. هُوَ الَّذِي يُرِيكُمُ الْبَرْقَ خَوْفًا وَطَمَعًا. It is He who shows you the lightning, causing you fear and hope. Some people, when they see lightning, they're terrified. And also because it's telling about perhaps a very severe thunderstorm coming. Other people, when they see lightning, they get hopeful that there's going to be rain falling on their crops. So He is the one who shows you lightning, causing fear and causing hope, and He is the one who produces the heavy clouds. And وَيُصَبِّحُ الرَّعْدُ بِحَمْدِهِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ مِنْ خِيفَتِهِ. And the thunder praises His glory, as do the angels in awe of Him. وَيُرْسِلُ الصَّوَاعِقَ. And He sends the thunderbolts, striking with them whoever He wills, even as they argue about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, while He is yet tremendous in might. Our books of Tafsir, they mention a story that it is perhaps that one of the people in the time of the Quraysh, they were being very arrogant and haughty, and they were mocking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the messenger, and so a thunderbolt, a lightning comes and strikes him, and so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referencing this incident over here. But because of this ayah, because of this verse, that the thunder praises His glory, because of this verse, وَيُسَبِّحُ الرَّعْدُ بِحَمْدِهِ, the verse or the surah itself is called the surah of thunder. And truly, this surah, it is like thunder. It moves you, it terrifies you, it astonishes you, it blinds you in its eloquence. And I encourage all of you to listen. It's a very short surah. I encourage all of you to listen to this surah in any beautiful recitation. And I recommend, if you don't have any option on your own, I recommend up-and-coming Qari, a young Qari by the name of Hazza' al-Balushi. You will find him online. He has a very nice rendition of Surah Ar-Ra'd. Surah Ar-Ra'd, as we said, it is a Makki surah. And there are, of course, the same goals of the Makki surah. Tawheed, Risala, and Akhirah. The oneness of Allah, the affirmation of the prophethood of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the proof that there is going to be a resurrection. But you know, no matter how many times the same themes come up, every single time it is done in a unique manner, in a fashion that it is as if it is absolutely fresh. It's as if the first time we are reading it. We never get tired of hearing the Quranic styles of affirming these three concepts. And this surah in particular, it beautifully describes the evidences for the existence of Allah and that He alone is worthy of being worshipped. And by the way, this surah and all of the surahs of the Quran, They always make a point of linking these two things together. And that is the existence of Allah and then the fact that He alone deserves to be worshipped. And this is a very important Quranic principle that is in contradistinction to many philosophers and theologians who try to go into a lot of detail proving that there is a God. They go into extraordinary detail. And frankly, their proofs are typically quite confusing and complicated. The Quran, firstly, the proofs are very simple. They appeal to common sense. You don't have to have a PhD in philosophy to understand, which is what you would think. Something as self-evident as the existence of God should not require complicated proofs. And so firstly, the Quranic proofs, they appeal to common sense. Everybody understands them. And secondly, and this is the main point, the Quran is not satisfied merely by telling you there's a God. That's something the philosophers do. The Quran wants you to then base your life around this reality. The Quran wants you to venerate and worship and then to obey the commandments of this God, to humble yourself in front of this Creator and to glorify Him. So this surah, it is one of the most powerful surahs in this regard, as we will see. This surah as well has some responses to the misconceptions that the idolaters have of the Islamic message of Tawheed, and it describes the Quran and it describes the people of faith and their rewards in paradise. And the surah begins by beautifully describing certain aspects of the creation. So verse number 2, Allahu alladhi rafa'a as-samawati bighayri 'amadin tarawnaha. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has raised the heavens without any pillars that you can see. He has controlled the sun and the moon, each one of them running its course. He conducts all affairs and He has clarified all the signs so that you may be certain of your meeting with Him in the hereafter. Verse number 3, wa huwa alladhi مَدَّ الْأَرْضِ. And He it is who has spread out this earth. He has made it so vast, and He has placed therein mountains and rivers. Meaning, the earth is not all the same. The earth is not all boring. There is variety. If Allah had willed, the earth would be exactly the same everywhere. But no, He it is who has beautified this earth, made different things in different locations. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِن كُلِّ الثَّمَرَاتِ. And from every fruit, He has produced many varieties and pears. In other words, there isn't just one type of apple, one type of orange, one type of grape. No, from every single fruit, you even have variety over there. يُغْشِ اللَّيْلَ النَّهَارِ. He covers the day with the night. Truly in this are signs for those who reflect. وَفِي الْأَرْضِ قِطَعٌ مُتَجَاوِرَاتٌ. And on earth, there are different types of lands neighboring one another. Gardens of grapes and others of crops and others of palm trees. Some of them, they are stemming from the same vines. Others have independent roots. In other words, Allah is saying, look at the diversity of plants around you. So for example, imagine cabbages or tomatoes. They're on the same vine versus apples or pears or dates. They're growing on one fruit. And Allah says, in different parts of the same land, one part is this, one part is that, يُسْقَى بِمَاءٍ وَاحِدٍ. All of them are being fed with the same water. وَنُفَضِّلُ بَعْضَهَا عَلَى بَعْضٍ فِي الْأُكُلِ. And we prefer some of them over others in taste. Not everything that comes from the ground is edible. Not everything tastes the same. Some fruits are more prized than others. Allah is saying, in all of this are signs for people who reflect. The perfection of the world around us, it demonstrates the perfection of the one who created it. How can you not see the signs of Allah all around you? Then Allah says, verse number 5, وَإِن تَعْجَبْ فَعَجَبٌ قَوْلُهُمْ. If this amazes you, if this is astounding, do you want to know what is more astounding? Do you want to know what is more amazing? It is their claim, the claims of those who reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that what? When we become dust, shall we be raised up again as a new creation? Subhanallah, look at these verses, how masterfully, how seamlessly Allah links the beauty of His creation with His power, with the reality of resurrection, with the status of the Prophet ﷺ, because Allah speaks to him, if you, Ya Rasulullah, are amazed, he's speaking to the singular, then let me tell you something more amazing than this. How can somebody doubt my power after seeing all of this and say, how can there be a resurrection? Notice in these three verses how Allah beautifully links the proofs of His existence with the fact that He deserves to be worshipped, with the fact that the Prophet ﷺ is a prophet honored by Allah, with the fact that there's going to be a hereafter. Truly mind-boggling, simple phrases that have such such profound meanings. We also see in the surah as well, time and time again, the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also this surah has a sub-motif of the blessings of the righteous and the status that they have. So in one verse, very important, verse number 11, لَهُ مُعَقِّبَاتٌ, that Allah Azza wa Jal has placed angels in front of those whom He has chosen and behind them, and they protect the chosen person, they protect him from the decrees of Allah, meaning by the decrees of Allah. So the angels are surrounding the righteous. This shows us that the righteous people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does have angels that are there protecting them and making sure that nothing happens to them except that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself has willed. And then Allah has a very, very famous verse that we all say, meaning we say it all the time, that in this surah it is this verse that إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ, that truly Allah does not change the status of a people until they change what is in themselves. And this ayah clearly shows that anytime something is taken away, a blessing is taken away, then we have done something to take that, to have that blessing taken away. And we are currently under this COVID crisis lockdown. We're currently being deprived of many blessings that we typically were accustomed to. So we need to think long and hard. What has humanity done as a whole to deserve this? And then we need to strive individually that we better ourselves at least, so that we save ourselves in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also in this surah, there is a very beautiful passage about the characteristics of the believers. And in fact, in this passage, there are 10 characteristics. Beautiful. Verse number 19 onwards, that Allah Azza wa Jal says that those who know the truth, they know that what has been revealed to you, that is true. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the one who recognizes this, is he the same as the one who is blind? The one who believes, so this is point number one, that they know what has been revealed to you is true. Are they the same? كَمَنْ هُوَ أَعْمَى? Are they the same as the one who is blind? Surely, blind meaning here not physically blind. Obviously, when the Quran says blind, of course the common meaning is spiritually blind, like he's not seeing, that Allah gave him a heart and yet his heart is not seeing. As Allah says in the Quran, that فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَعْمَى الْأَبْصَارُ وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَى الْقُلُوبُ الَّتِي فِي الصُّدُورِ, that this arrogance that they have, it doesn't cause blindness of the eyes, it causes blindness of the heart that is in the chest. That is the real blindness, the blindness of the heart. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the one who recognizes the truth, is he the same as the one who is spiritually blind? Surely the people of intelligence are the ones who reflect. إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. And before I move on to the other 9 points, a quick pause here, that the Quran praises, throughout the Quran, it praises the people of intelligence, the people who ponder, the people who think. And this really shows us a very important point. When the Quran praises the people of intelligence, what Allah means by them is not those who have the highest IQs or the PhDs in neurosurgery or what it might be. Those might be intelligent from one angle, nobody's denying that. But if a person's intelligence does not lead them to ask the most important questions of life, which is why we are here and what we are doing, and if a person's intelligence does not lead to the conclusion that life is worth living for a higher cause, that there is a higher power, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists and is worthy of being worshipped, then of what use was the faculty of reasoning when it wasn't employed for the most important aspect of existence? Of what use is a dozen PhDs if you're not actually worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And that is why real intelligence is not measured by memorizing some exams or some IQ tests or getting a secular degree. I agree, that might measure one type of intelligence, nobody's denying that. But the real intelligence is not measured by those degrees. The real intelligence is the spiritual one, and that is the awareness that I am here for a reason. And that is why the average worshipper of Allah, who firmly believes in meeting Allah and firmly knows the truth, he is infinitely more spiritually intelligent than somebody who has the highest degrees from the most prestigious universities in the most abstract fields. That level of intelligence might indeed be there in one area, but it has failed in the most important aspect, and that is is the most important reason why are we here and what are we doing. So understand, Allah praises the people of knowledge and the people of intelligence, and what He means by this is different than how we understand the people of knowledge and intelligence. So Allah is saying, إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. The people of intelligence are the ones who understand. So number one is that they believe in Allah. Number two, who are they? That the people of intelligence are the ones who understand that they are the ones who fulfill the covenants of Allah. الَّذِينَ يُفُونَ بِعَهْدِ اللَّهِ وَلَا يَنْقُضُونَ الْمِيثَاقِ. And they do not break their words. And they fulfill, or they make sure that they're fulfilling the ties of kinship. They're good to their family. Number four. Number five, وَيَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ. They fear their Lord. And number six, they are dreading the day of reckoning. They're waiting and they know that there's going to be a day of reckoning. Number seven, those who are patient, desiring the pleasure of their Lord. Number eight, they pray regularly. Number nine, they spend from what we have given them in secret and in open. And number 10, they respond to evil with goodness. They don't respond to evil with evil. They respond to evil with goodness. Allah says, after those who have been characterized by all of these 10, أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عُقُبَ الدَّارِ. These are the people, they have the ultimate abode, they have the best house, they have the eternal house. جَنَّاتُ عَدْنِ يَدْخُلُونَهَا. Everlasting gardens, they shall enter upon them. جَنَّاتُ عَدْنِ يَدْخُلُونَهَا. وَمَنْ صَلَحَ مِنْ آبَائِهِمْ وَأَزْوَاجِهِمْ وَذُرِّيَّاتِهِمْ. And whoever was righteous from their parents and ancestors, and from their spouses, and from their children and descendants. وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ يَدْخُلُونَ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ بَابٍ. And the angels are entering in upon them from every single door. They're in the gardens, and they're surrounded by these beautiful doors with where the angels are coming in. And what do the angels say? سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِمَا صَبَرْتُمْ. Peace be unto you, because you were patient, you were waiting for this day. فَنِعْمَ عُقْبَ الدَّارِ. What a beautiful abode that you have been given. This verse, dear Muslims, this verse is so beautiful. Why? Allah is saying, families will be together in Jannah. Families will be together in Jannah as long as they were righteous together in this world. Allah explicitly says, آبائهم, ذرياتهم, أزواجهم, the ones that their relatives that they were with, وَمَنْ صَلَحَ, those who are righteous amongst them. And so this is such a good news for those who have lost a loved one, lost a relative. SubhanAllah, it is a temporary, it's painful, yes. But inshaAllah ta'ala, you shall be permanently reunited with them. Where? In the abodes of eternal bliss. Are surrounded by what? By the angels entering it upon them, servicing them, doing them khidmah, saying salam to them. The whole ambience is one of pleasantries, and you will be with your relatives that you have lost in this world. You will be with them in the next life for all of eternity. And this is such a great blessing for us believers, that families will be together in Jannah. We are also reminded in this surah, verse number 26, we are reminded of another reality of this world, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dispenses of the provisions of the rizq. لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَقْدِرُ يَبْسُطْ. Allah gives to whomever He wants, and Allah restricts to whomever He wants. In other words, Allah is stating that I control the amount of wealth everyone has, and I choose the amount of wealth, and everyone is given the wealth that I have decided. And some people I have given a lot to. There are those who have millions, there are those who have hundreds of millions, there are those who have billions of dollars, and others, they don't have that much. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَفَرِحُوا بِالْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. And they take delight in this world. وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا فِي الْآخِرَةِ إِلَّا مَتَاعٌ. But what is this world and all of the pleasures of this world in comparison to the next, except for a fleeting pleasure, a temporary pleasure? Mata is like one meal, you enjoy it and that's it, it's gone. It's a temporary thing. So in this verse, notice Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that it is His decision how much wealth a person has, and Allah decides to test or bless people with different amounts of wealth. And no matter what we are given, it can be a blessing and it can be a test at the same time. And we have to pass that test. And then Allah reminds all of us that, hey, whatever you have, don't make this world your ultimate goal. Don't make this world the source of your pleasure, because Allah says they enjoy this world. وَفَرِحُوا بِالْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. And He ascribes it to people that He is distant from. This is not my worshippers. These are not my people. Those people enjoy this world. Those people consider this world to be the ultimate. And what is this world except a fleeting pleasure? We're allowed to enjoy this world, but our emphasis, our goal, our desire is the next world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives provisions to those whom He loves and those whom He doesn't love. This world, He gives it to one, those who reject Him and those who accept Him. This world is not a sign of His love. وَفَرِحُوا بِالْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. This world He gives to everyone, but even those who love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they have it, they don't prioritize this world. They prioritize the next world. What is the real pleasure then? Where do we get the real pleasure? Allah says in verse number 28, أَلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Those who believe, their hearts, they find contentment and happiness in the dhikr of Allah. Those who believe, their hearts find peace in the remembrance of Allah. And then, five words, memorize them in Arabic and then in your language. In Arabic, memorize them. Ala بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. Five words. Inscribe this into your memory and act upon it. Allah. Allah, in Arabic, it is a word that is meant to draw your attention. Don't you know? Verily, indeed, Allah. Don't you know this? What should you know? بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Only through the remembrance of Allah will the hearts find tranquility. Every one of us, our hearts are troubled. Every one of us, the problems of this world, they come to us from left and right and back and forth and top and bottom. Every one of us, we have worries and griefs of this world. We would not be human if we didn't have those worries and griefs. Do you know what the solution is to those worries and griefs? Do you know the way out of your problems? Memorize these five words and act upon them. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. We will only find happiness in the remembrance of Allah. And the remembrance of Allah is the Quran, it is the Salah, it is Dhikr, it is making Dua, it is making Istighfar. In the worship of Allah, in connecting with Allah, that is where our hearts will find tranquility. So this surah tells us that is the real happiness. Not وَفَرِعُوا بِالْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, not this world and whoever is a multi-billionaire. That's not where the happiness lies. The happiness lies with the one who worships Allah and who feels the sweetness and the pleasure of the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, this surah has one verse that I have to pause at because it's a very, very important verse which deals with a totally separate topic. We've brought it up a few times before, and that is the topic of qadar or predestination. And of course, much can be said. We don't have time to go into too much, but this verse is one of the key points that we extract our beliefs in qadar in. Verse number 39, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ar-Rad, يَمْحُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيُثْبِتُ وَعِندَهُ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala erases whatever He wants, and Allah allows to pass or affirms whatever He wants, and with Him is the source of the book, or the mother of the book, or the Ummul Kitab. And our scholars of Tafsir and the books of Hadith, we extrapolate from this that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written down everything that will happen. And at some level, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, He knows and controls everything unconditionally. At the same time, Allah Azza wa Jal can allow qadr to change. And of course, Allah knew that the qadr would change. So this is what Allah is saying, that sometimes I erase something from the book and sometimes allow it to pass. And Allah Azza wa Jal has the original, Allah has the source. And of course, the details of this are beyond the scope, but in a nutshell, what this ayah references is that it is possible to change. There are levels of qadr. Some of our scholars have derived five levels of qadr, and they go from low to high. And it is possible to change a lower level of qadr, but Allah knew at a higher level that the lower level would change. And the lower level will change because of something we have done, because of a dua that we have made, because of a sadaqah and charity we have given, that our Prophet ﷺ said, that give charity on behalf of your sick, it will cure them. So when we give charity, then inshaAllah ta'ala, it will have a spiritual impact, it might cure them. So Allah Azza wa Jalla knew that we would give charity and that would impact the person. So this is a longer topic, but this is one of the key verses that is used in this regard. And Surah Ar-Ra'd ends by affirming in very powerful words that indeed the Prophet ﷺ is a true prophet, and it doesn't matter even if they negate it, Allah's testimony is enough, and their negation doesn't change the fact that indeed our Nabi is the Nabi and Rasul of Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. Our next surah is Surah Ibrahim, and as I said, it is also a mid-era Makki surah. And it is a very, very, again, beautiful, very powerful surah, 6 pages. And subhanAllah, just on a personal note, when I was memorizing the Quran, I remember I was very happy as a teenager that this was the surah I memorized in the shortest amount of time per page. I think it took me 2-2.5 days to memorize the whole surah, because I found it, even though subhanAllah, when I memorized the Quran, by the way, this is a tangent, when I memorized the Quran, I did not speak Arabic, I did not understand Arabic. Yet still, Surah Ibrahim was so, it just smooth, it just flew with me. And so I just memorized so much easily. And to this day, Surah Ibrahim remains one of my favorite surahs, because again, all surahs are so beautiful, but everybody has certain surahs that they have a bit of a soft spot for more than others, and for me, Surah Ibrahim will always be one of those surahs that I have a very special love for. And once again, I encourage all of you, and I love Shaykh Husari, of course, the classic, the master, Shaykh Khalil al-Husari. By the way, he is my favorite Qari completely of all times. Shaykh Mahmoud Khalil al-Husari, his Surah Ibrahim is very beautiful. Of course, all Qadis, mashallah, whoever you like. Anyway, the point is Surah Ibrahim. Surah Ibrahim is a surah that we said is also a Makki surah. And again, there are many standard motifs over here. And the surah begins by, once again, masterfully combining between the power of the Quran and the reality of the next life and the truth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Verse number 4, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ. And we have never sent a messenger except that he speaks the language of his people so that he can clarify and explain things to them. Allah never sent a messenger except he spoke the language of his people. And this is something that now, collectively, the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and especially its preachers and scholars, they collectively take on the role of teaching and preaching. And so we need to have preachers and teachers from every language. We need to have people who are trained in every language from those cultures, so that they teach their people what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to teach us. Surah Ibrahim, it mentions very briefly a number of prophets, Musa, Nuh, the prophets of Ad and Thamud, Allah mentions in the Quran, and we're informed in this surah that all of them were ridiculed, all of them were mocked, and they were rejected. And again, one of the main purposes of Surah Ibrahim is to console our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and everybody who walks in the footsteps of the prophets, everybody who stands up to preach Islam, everybody who starts talking and inviting others to the way of Allah. They are in some fashion or manner walking in the footsteps of the prophets before them, and so they're going to face in some fashion or manner some of the same aspects and ridicule and rejection that the prophets faced. And so Allah Azza wa Jal mentions these prophets and what they faced, so that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is fortified. And also in this surah is the beautiful verse that so many of us have heard in khutbas, in lectures and durus. Very, very beautiful verse. And in the context, Allah is saying this verse in the context of announcing to all of the nations. It's not just our nation. It is to the nation of Moses and the nations before us that Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَإِذْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكُمْ, your Lord announced to all of mankind. This is a rule that is universal and that is global. Your Lord has made adhan. Your Lord has announced. What is it? لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ وَلَإِن كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. That if you are grateful, then I shall increase what you have. And if you are ungrateful, then beware, my punishment is very severe. So if we want more, and all of us want more, and we want to remain blessed, we need to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is thanks? Thanks means the most important aspect of thanks is humility, is recognition. That is all that we just accept that Allah azza wa jal has given us. The opposite of thanks is kufr, and kufr means we deny, we negate, we say, this is from me, this is, I have done this. No, the essence of thankfulness when it comes to Allah is to acknowledge and recognize the source of our blessings. And then the perfection of thanks comes, this is the essence, the perfection of thanks comes that to utilize those blessings to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also in the context of these verses as well, verse number 10, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالَتْ لَهُمْ رُسُلُهُمْ, their prophets said to them, is there any doubt about Allah? أَفِلَّهِ شَكْ, is there any doubt about Allah, the one who originated the heavens and the earth? And this powerful question, it is one of the key rhetorical questions that our theologians, our scholars of aqeedah, they have derived from this, the beautiful point that the evidence for Allah's existence are self-explanatory. They are ingrained inside of us. Why? Because the question is rhetorical. Do you doubt the existence of Allah? Is there really, seriously a doubt? أَفِلَّهِ شَكْ? And you only ask a rhetorical question when you already know the answer. The purpose of the rhetorical question is to emphasize that which is already known. It is not meant to quiz, it is meant to emphasize. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, everybody knows that there is a God. How can you possibly deny that? قَالَتْ لَهُمْ رُسُلُهُمْ أَفِلَّهِ شَكْ? And again, this goes back to my point earlier in today's lecture, that the Quran does not have these convoluted, complicated proofs for Allah's existence, because you don't need such difficult proofs. The proofs for Allah's existence are self-evident, and it is only the arrogant who deny. That is why, no matter how complicated of a proof you bring, an arrogant person will not believe in those proofs, because it's not the proofs that he's denying, it is his arrogance that is denying the existence of Allah subhanahu Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Afillahi shak. Simple question. The next section, verses 10 to 14, they talk about the reality of the prophets being mocked and their perseverance and patience in the face of all odds. Anyone who is ridiculed or mocked for any aspect of religion, if somebody makes fun of you because you pray, if somebody makes fun of a sister because she wears hijab, if somebody says anything derogatory about your faith tradition, remember, the prophets faced much worse than you. And what did the prophets say? Verse number 12, that they said, we will put our trust in Allah. وَمَا لَنَا أَلَّا نَتَوَكَّلَ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Why shouldn't we go back to Allah? Why shouldn't we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after He has guided us to the best of ways? وَلَنَصْبِرَنَّ عَلَى مَا آذَيْتُمُونَ. Surely we will be patient in the face of all of your adversities and harms, and in Allah, let those who put their trust, put their trust. When people mock you for the sake of Allah, turn to Allah to give you that confidence. Turn to Allah to make you firm. Do not resort to vulgarities and mocking. Do not go down and stoop to their level. No, when people mock you, you turn up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you be the better of the two. And you say, we will put our trust in Allah and we will be patient for the sake of Allah because of the mockery that you have done. And you know what? There's a psychological aspect here. Dignity always wins over vulgarity. People who have good manners will win in the long run over those who have cheap manners. In the short run, maybe it looks like those who have vulgar manners will win. But in the long run, وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, the end result and the victory will always be for those who are pious. So this is a beautiful point that we learn over here. In the next section of Surah Ibrahim, the verse has a vivid description of the Day of Judgment, and that those people who followed others, who followed their icons, they will try to excuse themselves. Inna kunna lakum taba'an, that we used to follow you, that you were the ones who led us here. Verse 21 onwards. فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُغْنُونَ عَنَّا مِنْ عَذَابِ اللَّهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Can you now help us against the punishment of Allah? And this again, we have said this motif from the beginning of Surah Baqarah, and we're still continuing. The Quran is very clear. Every one of you, O human beings, you have been blessed with common sense, with intelligence. You don't just follow somebody blindly about the most important thing, and that is belief in Allah and the correctness of your religion. You have to think on your own. So Allah says, on the Day of Judgment, Those who used to follow false leaders, those who used to follow people who are telling them to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're going to now go to those leaders. And they're going to say, look, it's not our fault, it's your fault. You're the ones that told us to not worship Allah. You're the ones who opened the doors for evil, for filth. You're the ones who wanted us to enjoy this world. You're the ones who mocked the people of religion and we followed you. So now because we followed you, فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُغْنُونَ عَنَّا مِنْ عَذَابِ اللَّهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Are you going to protect us from the punishment of Allah? And what do those leaders say? The Quran is very clear. Just like their own teacher Iblis, just like their own master Iblis, they blame Allah for their sins. And they say, قَالُوا لَوْ هَدَانَ اللَّهُ لَهَدَيْنَاكُمْ. To the very end, when they're about to enter the fire of hell, they still cannot acknowledge, we did it. They acknowledge, A'udhu Billah, they say, Allah did it. A'udhu Billah. What arrogance. So even to the end, they are saying, it's not our fault. If Allah had guided us, we would have guided you. But Allah didn't guide us, so it's not our fault. To the very end, they will lead their followers to Jahannam, and they're still protesting their innocence. It's not our fault. How can you follow such arrogant, deluded leaders? Dear people of intelligence, think for yourselves. Religiosity is infinitely better than irreligiosity. Follow the religious folks, follow the believers of Allah, follow in the footsteps of the prophets, and do not follow those who want to open up doors of vice, doors of evil, doors of fahisha, doors of rejection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of what value is this? In this world you will suffer. In this world your heart is never going to be happy. In the next world you will want to have them to partake your punishment, and they will say, it's not our fault. You know, you're the ones, we didn't do anything. Allah didn't guide us. And then, a'udhu billah, they will go to Jahannam and they will lead their people behind them. We seek Allah's refuge. And we also have over here verse number 22, and this is one of the most powerful verses of this nature. And one of the scholars of the past, he said, this verse describes, he gave it a very interesting title, by the way, Ibn al-Qayyim, in one of his books, he said, this verse describes the khutbah of shaytan. Shaytan is going to give a khutbah. Shaytan is going to give a khutbah on the Day of Judgment, a sermon he's going to give. And the Quran summarizes, and in fact in some of our books of Tafsir, it mentions that Shaytan will gather, you know, his minions, his followers, and he will be given a podium, and he will address them before they go into the fire of hell. So this is the last address of Shaytan, a'udhu billah, that he's going to say, and Allah is describing it for us in such beautiful language and vivid detail. But who is there who will pay attention and benefit before it is too late? Brothers and sisters, we don't want to hear the khutbah live on that day. We want to benefit from it here so that we don't hear it from shaitan on that day. We don't want to be in that company. Allah is telling it to us in the Quran. Whoever truly believes in this khutbah of shaitan, he had better take the lesson here rather than hear it from shaitan's mouth himself. What is the khutbah? What is the sermon? وَقَالَ الشَّيْطَانُ لَمَّا قُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ. And shaitan will say, when everything has been settled, when judgment has been done, when heaven and hell has been assigned, shaitan will now stand up and he will announce to the people, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَعَدَكُمْ وَعْدَ الْحَقِّ. Allah was always telling you the truth. A'udhu billah, the very end, what use now is it going to be? When Iblis confesses, Allah was always telling you the truth. And as for me, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَعَدَكُمْ وَعْدَ الْحَقِّ وَوَعَدْتُكُمْ فَأَخْلَفْتُكُمْ. As for me, I promised you and I was lying. I betrayed you. I failed you. And then Iblis will say, so he at least confesses, Iblis, he will say at the end that, look, I was lying throughout all of this. Allah was telling the truth. And then Iblis will say, مَا كَانَ لِيَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ. But no, I had no power over you. You should know one thing, all of you around me, know one thing, that you, I had no power, I had no authority over you. I didn't force you. What did I do? إِلَّا أَنْ دَعَوْتُكُمْ فَاسْتَجَبْتُمْ لِي. All that I did, I called out to you, come to me. And you were the ones who came and answered my call. Iblis at least is being honest at the very end. Iblis is now coming clean and he is saying, look, Allah's promise was true and I was lying throughout all of this. But hey, don't get angry at me, because in the end of the day, all I did was I invited you and you came. So the Quran says, what is Iblis going to say? فَلَا تَلُومُونِي. Don't blame me. Don't get angry at me. وَلُومُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Blame yourselves and criticize yourselves. مَا أَنَا بِمُسْرِخِكُمْ وَمَا أَنتُمْ بِمُسْرِخِيَّ. I can't help you. You cannot help me. إِنِّي كَفَرْتُ بِمَا أَشْرَكْتُمُونِي مِنْ قَبْلِ. And this is such an amazing verse. If you were to translate this in half English, half Arabic, I do kufr of your shirk. That's what Iblis is saying. I reject your shirk that you would do with Allah using me. Inni kafartu bima ashraktumuni min qabl. I reject this all now, that all of this was false. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, indeed the wrongdoers shall have a painful punishment. Dear Muslims, Iblis is coming clean on the Day of Judgment. But right now, he is not. Allah is telling us what he's going to say at the end. How can we follow the plots of Iblis? Do not go to Shaytan and the followers of Shaytan. Go to the prophets and the followers of the prophets. They're the ones telling you the truth. And as for the believers, verse 23, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that those who did good, وَأُدْخِلَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ. Those who do good and those who believe, they will be admitted into gardens beneath which rivers flow. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ. They shall remain forever by the permission of Allah. تَحِيَّتُهُمْ فِيهَا سَلَامٌ. Their greetings will always be peace. It will be peaceful, serene. Everybody will be saying salam over there. Allah will be saying salam to them. The angel will be saying salam to them. The people will be saying salam to one another. And how do we get that fruit? How do we get the Jannah? How do we get there? Verse number 24. Have you not seen the parable that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given of the kalima tayyiba, of the good kalima? That parable is like that of a tree whose roots are firm and whose branches tower in the sky. It gives you its fruits in all seasons by the permission of Allah. And Allah gives parables to mankind so that they can reflect and ponder over these parables. So Allah is saying, I'm giving you an example, a metaphor of a beautiful, majestic tree whose roots go deep, its foundations are firm, its branches are towering in the sky, they're going to take you high up, and it's giving you all types of fruits in all types of seasons. And this is the tree of Iman, that when you put it in your heart and you let it grow in your heart, it will make your heart firm, it will give you strength and courage, and it will rise and rise and rise and take you all the way to the heavens. And on the way, you have all the fruits that you need, you have everything that is there, because it is the kalima tayyiba, and that is the kalima of La ilaha illallah. So Allah is saying, whoever has the kalima tayyiba, whoever has La ilaha illallah, he shall have that peace in this world, and he shall have the fruits of this world as well, and especially the fruits of the hereafter. And in the next passage of Surah Ibrahim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recounts many of the other blessings that He has given us. In verse 32, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that He has caused the rain to fall, He has caused the fruits to come as a means of food for us. وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمُ الْفُلْكَ وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمُ الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمُ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the power of using the ships in the ocean. And of course, by ships, every means of transportation. Notice here, ships are built by humans. But Allah is saying, I allowed you that power. And therefore, by extension, every single vehicle and means of transportation, we need to understand Allah has gifted us the intelligence. Allah has gifted us the power to then produce it. We still need to thank Allah, even though, of course, the ship is made by human hands. But where did we get that knowledge from? Where did we get that qudra from? Allah is gifting that to us, that He allows it easy for us. And also, Allah has gifted us the night and the day. And Allah has gifted us the sun and the moon. Notice the entire creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given all of this to us. And that's why Allah says in these series of verses, وَآتَاكُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ مَا سَأَلْتُمُوا. And He has given you all that you asked Him, He gave you portions of that. Whatever you asked Allah and whatever you didn't ask Allah, all of these blessings He has given you. And then He says, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. And if you were to try to count the blessings of Allah, if you were to sit down and start writing a list of all the blessings that Allah has given you, you would never be able to finish that list. You are not even capable of counting Allah's blessings. How about truly thanking Him for that? That's not going to be possible, but we attempt, we try. In reality, what Allah has given us cannot even be described by words. It cannot even be written in a list. It is more than a list can do. وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. You'll never be able to enumerate the blessings of Allah. And that is why Allah Azza wa Jalla says in this verse, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَظَلُومٌ كَفَّارٌ. That truly, man is unjust and ungrateful. But Allah Azza wa Jalla is not requiring a perfection. Allah is simply requiring our attempt, our recognizing that Allah Azza wa Jalla is the one who gives, and then we attempt to thank Him for that. And subhanAllah, notice the things that Allah mentions in this verse, the night and the day, the sun and the moon, vehicles of transportation. How many of us have even considered these as blessings that we take for granted? The biggest blessings of Allah, the sun and the moon, the night and the day, the world around us, we just take it for granted. And Allah is saying, سَخَّرَ لَكُمْ, I did all of this for you so that your life is easier. And other verses mention sleep and walking in the day. Other verses mention hearing and seeing. All of these blessings that we just take for granted, Allah Azza wa Jalla, all that He wants for our benefit, not for His, that we acknowledge them and then turn to Him humbly, worshipping and praising Him. Surah Ibrahim, of course, is named Surah Ibrahim, even though many surahs have the story of the Prophet Ibrahim, because in this surah, there is a half a page dedicated to the du'as of Ibrahim. So it's a very moving section of this surah. And again, dear brothers and sisters, remember, the purpose of my lectures is not so that you don't read the section. It is so that it acts as a primer, that you listen to me and then you go and read the entire section, and especially Surah Ra'd and Surah Ibrahim, you will finish them in 15-20 minutes each. Even that is too much. Just small surahs, just listen to them in Arabic, read them in Arabic, and then read the translation. It's such a beautiful surah, and these sections now are some of the most powerful du'as of the Quran. So read verses 35 to 41, and these du'as, they explain to us some of the, if you like, psychological frame of mind of the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. So what is Ibrahim alayhi salam asking for? What is on his mind? You know, what is Ibrahim want from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So Ibrahim has built the Kaaba by Allah's permission and legacy. And so by Allah's permission. And he wants to preserve that legacy. وَإِذْ قَالَ Ibrahim, remember when Ibrahim said, وَإِذْ قَالَ Ibrahim, this is verses 35 onwards, رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا. O Allah, make this land a blessed land, a safe land. Oh Allah, make this land a safe place. And remember, when is this dua being said? This dua was said when Ibrahim had left Hajar and Ismail in front of the Kaaba, and he had left, and he didn't know who was going to take care of him. The Kaaba had yet to be built, of course, but he had left Ibrahim and Hajar in the valley of Mecca, and there was nobody there. And he turned around, it is said in the books that he turned around with tears streaming from his eyes, because he doesn't know who will take care of Hajar, who will take care of Ismail. And he raised his hands up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, oh Allah, protect the people of this valley, protect the people of this land, and allow people to come to this valley that will worship you. So Ibrahim made dua that civilization comes to Mecca. There was nothing there, not even a bird was in the heavens at that point in time. And so subhanAllah, the tribe of Jurhum, one of the ancient Arabian tribes, they passed by and they found a lady with a boy and a well. And then the story of Mecca begins. This is answering the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. This is answering his dua that, oh Allah, that allow for people to come, and waj'al afidatan min an-nasi tahwi ilayhim, allow people's hearts to come towards Mecca. And to this day, our hearts want to go to Mecca and our faces face Mecca. So Ibrahim made dua to Allah that, oh Allah, make people come here and provide for them safety and security, and provide for them food and drink. وَارْزُقْهُمْ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ. So subhanAllah, he wanted his children to have safety and security and wealth. Who doesn't want that? It's human nature. We make dua to Allah for that. But then, what did he tag on? What condition did he add? لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ لِيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةِ. Both of these are mentioned. Oh Allah, allow them to be thankful. Oh Allah, allow them to be of those who pray. We do not ask for wealth for the sake of wealth. We do not ask for long life for the sake of long life. We do not ask for the blessings of this world for the sake of the blessing of this world. Yes, we ask for wealth and long life and blessings, but then we add on, and oh Allah, make me righteous with them. And oh Allah, allow me to be thankful for them. And oh Allah, allow me to be of those who are regular in their prayers. So never ask Allah a blessing of this world without adding to it, and allow me to use it in a way that is pleasing to you. Because we don't want a blessing of this world to become a curse. No, not at all. That's why when Ibrahim alayhi salam makes dua For blessings of this world, he always adds a condition so that they may also be thankful, so that they can also be praying to you. So it is completely legitimate and permissible, and it is a part of human nature to ask Allah for the blessings of this world. For us and our children, Ibrahim's a father, he's left his son, he's left his partner in Mecca, and he's feeling, I need to take care of them. And so he makes dua to Allah, oh Allah, provide food for them, oh Allah, provide safety for them, and oh Allah, make sure they are thankful when they do that. And then, what is his final dua? رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي. Along with the du'as of wealth and health and money and fame, along with the du'as of safety and security, the most important du'a, O Allah, make me righteous and make my children righteous as well. O Allah, make me of those who pray regularly and make my children of those who pray regularly. Never ever forget to make du'a for your children, for your loved ones, for the du'as of religion, the du'as of guidance, the du'as of prayer. As he's building the Kaaba in the sacred land of Mecca, what is on his mind? I want my children to be righteous children of Allah. That is the real legacy, that you leave your faith in a strong hands with your children. That is the legacy you should be proud of. And then Surah Ibrahim, it ends with some very powerful descriptions of the Day of Judgment once again, and of wrongdoers asking for more time when the angel of death comes, and Allah Azza wa Jal asks them, you're asking for more time? Didn't you live your life thinking that you would live forever? Wasn't your frame of mind that death would never come? أَوَلَمْ تَكُونُوا أَقْسَمْتُمْ مِنْ قَبْلُ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ زَوَالٍ. The way you were living your lives, you were living them as if there is no end. Why now do you want the delay? You had never thought of this. So we need to be very, very cognizant, dear Muslims. We all have a time that we're going to be leaving this world. We need to be prepared for the angel of death when the angel comes. And then the verses conclude, فَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ اللَّهَ غَافِلًا عَمَّا يَعْمَلُ الظَّالِمُونَ وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ اللَّهَ مُخْلِفَ وَعْدِهِ رُسُلَهُ. Verses 47 onwards, that don't ever think that Allah will not live up to his promise that he made to the prophets. Judgment will come. Allah promised it, and it is going to come. And when judgment comes, verse number 48, يَوْمَ تُبَدَّلُ الْأَرْضُ غَيْرَ الْأَرْضِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتِ. On that day, all of this earth shall be substituted for another earth, and all of the skies shall be substituted for other skies. وَبَرَزُوا لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَارِ. And on that day, all of the creation shall appear before Allah, the One, the Mighty. And what will happen on that day? Again, the final verse of the surah. لِيَجْزِيَ اللَّهُ كُلَّ نَفْسٍ مَّا كَسَبَتْ. So that every single person, this is what the surah concludes, so that every single person shall have to own up to what he or she has done. Every person will get back what they have done. Verily, إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَرِيعُ الْحِسَابِ. Verily, Allah is swift in reckoning. We all will have to face Allah on that day. We all will have to think long and hard and then account for our lives. So therefore, before we are questioned, before the examination, let us prepare for that exam. Let us make sure we have our answers ready. Let us make sure that our actions will speak louder than our tongue, because on that day, the tongue will not speak, only the actions will speak. Let us be prepared to meet Allah, for He is indeed swift in reckoning. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us and our children, to grant our children the best so that they can be thankful. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us and our progeny of those who pray and who fast and who love the Quran. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us and guide our children and their children after us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to pass away in this world only when He is happy with us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow the kalima to be the last thing that we say, the kalima tayyiba of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. And inshallah ta'ala, we'll continue tomorrow. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم ومن كان مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر ولتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم ولعلكم تشكرون.